So let's begin.
Just a bit.
So, good morning and welcome to the third keynote lecture. It is a real pleasure for me to introduce José Manuel García Aznar, or Manu, as we call him. The first ESB Congress in Spain needed to have a Spanish keynote speaker. The first one in years, or maybe the first one ever, I don't know. That's the reason why I invited him, probably the top biomechanics researcher in Spain. I first met Manu in 2001 when he took over my PhD supervision. I will always thank him for taking me out of the boring classical mechanics and into the exciting world of biomechanics. He's always been a reference for me, for his work capacity and his prolific output. Manu is full professor at the University of Zaragoza, but he's been a visiting researcher at Kiel University, KU Leuven, and Cambridge University. Despite being young, he has authored around 200 papers and received almost 4,000 citations. He began researching in bone biomechanics, but then moved to cellular biomechanics some years ago, and recently received a grant from the European Research Council to focus his activity on cell motility, the topic he will address today. This change was not a problem for him. Actually, I do believe that he can research in any field he puts his mind to, especially working around the clock like he does. I must say that Manu is a great scientist, but overall, he's a good person. Thank you, Manu, for coming.
Okay, now much better. Thank you very much, Javi, for your kind words. It's a pleasure for me to be here, and thank you also very much for giving me the opportunity to present what I am currently doing. So my work currently is mainly focused to try to understand how cells move, and for that we combine experiments and numerical models. So first, I would like to say that cell migration is a key phenomenon that is involved in many relevant, many fundamental processes like bone healing or bone fracture healing, tissue regeneration, morphogenesis, and cancer metastasis. In order to understand how cells move, please let me make a simple analogy. I'm going to compare how we move in comparison with how one cell moves. So when we move, we use our musculoskeletal system to do exercise, to do movements. For that, the cell have the cytoskeleton. The cytoskeleton is a dynamic part of the skeleton and is mainly composed by three kinds of filaments. Actin, that is in blue in this picture, microtubule, that is in green, and intermediate filament that are in red. This part is the cytoskeleton, is the skeleton of the cell. But we normally are able to do forces. The cells are able to do forces. For that, they use different kind of molecular motors, where myosin is the one of the most relevant. And we can observe that the cells are able to exert forces for moving, but also to prove and to sense how is the environment that surrounds the cell. When we move over a 2D surface, we exert pressure on the floor. When the cells are moving on a 2D surface, not only exert forces, but also the cells can adhere to the substrate using what is called the focal adhesion. So there are some proteins that are able to adhere to the substrate. But when one cell is embedded in three dimensions, the cell is surrounded by fibers of the extracellular matrix of our tissues. In this analogy, I think it's very similar to what happened when children are climbing in 3D grades of rope. So they try to move in this three-dimensional way. So in order to advance to understand a little bit more how the cells are moving, I'm going to focus in how are the different processes that occur in 2D. So normally, the first process is polarization. So the cell tend to define which is the front part and the rear part. It is what is called a well-defined polarization. But sometimes, this polarization is not well-defined, and there is a competition to define this polarization. After the polarization, we can observe that there is formation of protrusions. Protrusions are due to actin, one of the elements of the cytoskeleton, that are polymerizing. And then they are pushing the membrane in order to advance. At the same time, the cell is able to create adhesions to the substrate. So they are pushing and creating adhesions. Later, what happens is in the cell body, there is contraction. And there is the rear detachment in the back part of the cell. All those processes occur in a continuous way. So in this way, the cells start to move. This is what's happening in 2D. In 3D, the process is very similar. We also have formation of protrusion. We can see in this picture the different actin filaments, how they are polymerizing. And later, there are additions to the extracellular matrix. The main difference in 2D and in 3D is in 3D, the cells not only are able to deform the matrix, but also they are able to degrade the matrix. So the second process is degradation. So there are elements called metalloproteases that are able to degrade the matrix for creating more space. And finally, there is contraction and also rear detachment. So to visualize a little bit more how cells are moving, we can observe here in these two films the different movement of cells. This is mouse fibroblasts moving in 2D, and in the other picture, we can see how cells move in a collagen 3D structure. We can clearly observe different morphologies, although all of them are doing a similar cycle or a similar set of processes. So it's clear that the environment are regulating the mechanical and the way that the cells are moving. So we can observe that different extracellular matrix, we can observe here different extracellular matrix or soluble factors. For example, in extracellular matrix, there are relevant factors like the stiffness of the matrix or the chemical factors that are bound to the matrix or the topography of the matrix. But also, if we include soluble factors, like chemical factors, they can migrate in a preferential direction. For example, we can see here in this picture how cells tend to move toward the upper part of the picture in order to follow a chemical gradient. So it's clear that there are different environmental cues that is regulating migration. So if we divide it in factors associated to the extracellular matrix are relevant the geometry. It's important the mechanics of this matrix, the chemistry, and also, of course, the concentration, the composition of this matrix. But also there are external factors. For example, the application of fluid flow or the application of external load, like we could see yesterday in one of the students' awards, or the application of chemical factors. There is a recent work that, a review work that tried to classify the three fundamental aspects for defining cell migration. That is, the first one is the level of adhesion. So if the cells are very, very much able to adhere to the matrix, that is what normally occurs, the process is very similar to what I have explained. The cells try to deform, but also to degrade the matrix. It is what normally called mesenchymal migration. However, sometimes the adhesion is very low. So when the adhesion is low, cells tend to create blebbins, and the way of movement is more similar to a bacteria. Of course, dimensionality is the second relevant factor. We can observe that it's different if the cell moves over a surface, over two surfaces, or a 3D matrix. And finally, that is very relevant, the difference when the cells move individually or collectively. As I'm going to show now, the collective movement is not simply the addition of individual movement of many cells. So the main aim of my presentation is to try to investigate how mechanical conditions regulate cell migration. In particular, I'm going to focus in three main examples. I'm going to try to advance in the understanding of how matrix stiffness regulates collective 2D migration, how the role of matrix stiffness influence 3D migration, and finally, I'm going to show some results of how the stiffness of the cell is very relevant for 3D migration. I'm going to follow this following research strategy. I'm going to try to make a question, and I'm going to combine design experiments that in sometimes we are developing, but in other times we collaborate with other groups. And in parallel, we are going to create a model. So the idea is to compare both results, and with the feedback that we obtain, we improve the experiment and at the same time refine the model. But please, we have to keep in mind the ideas that Professor Migliavacca discussed yesterday about the validity of models. So keeping in mind this idea, we are going to combine these two techniques. So I'm going to start with the collective 2D migration. First of all, I'm going to try to explain what is called durotaxis. Durotaxis is called the phenomenon in when the cells tend to move toward the direction of more to the side there is stiffer properties. Okay? So there are many papers about that, but the most classical and the most cited paper it was developed by Law. In this experiment, it's very simple. They create a surface, but there is one side that has a low property that is called soft, but what happens is the stiffness is very low, and then later there is another side in which the stiffness is very high. If you see on your left, when the cell is cultured in the soft side, the cell tend to move toward the stiffer side. However, when the cell is cultured in the stiffer side, the cell never moves to the soft side. So this phenomenon is normally called durotaxis. But what happened, instead of having this step gradient, we have a more smooth gradient. If we have this kind of gradient, we can observe that when cells are moving, they don't tend to move toward the side, to the stiffer side. The movement is more random. So the cells are not able, in this case, to sense this difference in the stiffness. But what happened, instead of culture individual cells, we culture a monolayer of cells. We have developed this work in collaboration with the laboratory of Professor Trepat and Professor Roca Cusach in Barcelona. And what we did is to to culture cells, a monolayer of cells, in a uniform, and the top is in a uniform stiffness distribution and in a gradient, in a stiffness gradient distribution. And we can see how the cells, how the stiffer, modify the tendency of the monolayer movement. The monolayer start to extend. In the uniform case, we can observe that the monolayer extension is completely symmetric. However, in the case that we have a stiffer gradient stiffness, we observe clearly a tendency toward the stiffer side. We try to measure more things in order to investigate what happened. We evaluate stresses, displacement. And the most relevant case is observed in the displacement. If we observe the displacement in the uniform case, is on the left, we can observe that the displacements are symmetric. However, if we focus in the gradient stiffness, we observe that the displacements are not symmetric. We observe there are larger displacements on the soft side in comparison with the stiffer side. So, what happened? We try to understand this phenomenon is only a consequence of the balance of forces. If we imagine a very long cell that is adhered in the stiff side and the soft side, and we try to do forces, what happens is in the soft side, the cell is able to, when it is contracting, the cell is able to deform much more. So the displacements are much bigger. And in the other side, it's stiffer, the cell is not able to deform. So the tendency of the center of mass is to move toward the side of stiffer properties. With this idea, this simple idea, we create a model that describes this phenomenon. So we incorporate different cells. Later, we incorporate the substrate with the properties, the additions, the dynamics of different additions, and finally, the cell-cell connection. The model is very simple. I'm going to briefly describe each of these components. So, the cell has three parts. In the central part, we have the contractile rod. That is only the part where the cell is exerting contractile forces. Later, we have two zones, that is the adhesive zones, is the area where the cell is going to be able to adhere to the substrate. And finally, we have the places, the last endings, is in the edge, where polymerization and the polymerization of the cell occur. So in this way, the cell is growing. With this simple idea, we have the model of the cell. Later, we incorporate a model of the substrate. The substrate is only a set of trace elements with a variable properties of stiffness, and we incorporate the ligand points, and we model the cell-cell interaction a single spring, simple spring. So the more complicated is the addition, because the dynamic of addition is very relevant. So the addition, we simulate, you can see in this picture, the addition complex, and is in this picture, and this complex can bind to the cell, to the actin filament, or can bind to the ligand. So initially, these additions are free, so we follow a Brownian dynamics motion, and when the addition bind to one of them, can bind to the matrix or to the actin. And in function, it is regulated mainly by the distance. So the binding, we assume, is only regulated by the distance. And later, when it is bound, what we assume are catch-slip bound law. It means that when the addition is bound to the actin and to the substrate, it's transmitting force from the cell to the substrate. If this force is very low, unbinding is going to occur. If this force is very high, a failure of the addition is going to occur. So I'm going to show a very short video where we are going to see a step gradient, and we're going to see how is the tendency. I'm sorry, this is a problem with Mac. I couldn't move the video correctly, okay? But you can observe how the center of mass tend to move toward the side, the stiffer side. So in this case, we can observe in a gradient how the cell is extending, and clearly we can observe how it's advancing much more toward the side of much more stiffness. And later, what we try to do is we are going to modify the different mechanical conditions in order to understand, to improve the understanding of the phenomena, and also to test the model. So the first idea, what we did, is we modify the gradient. So we can have a steep gradient or a shallow gradient. What is the difference? So our model predicts these results. When we have a uniform gradient, of course, in the vertical axis we have the center of mass, in the horizontal we have the initial cluster offset, that is the position of the center of mass, the initial position of the center of mass of the monolayer. So when we have a uniform gel, there is no durotaxis. When we have a steep gradient, we have more durotaxis than if we use a shallow gradient. And we can observe that if the cell is located in the soft side, the durotaxis is much bigger. You can see it here. However, if we locate the cell, the cluster, in the stiffer side, the durotaxis is lower. So we observe that if we locate the cluster on the stiffer side, the durotaxis is decreased. If we locate the cluster in the soft side, the durotaxis is higher. It's much more efficient. So we measure this data, and we can observe that the model is able to predict the same tendency that was quantified in the experiments. The next step is, of course, it depending on the kind of gradient that we have. But of course, the size of the cluster is very relevant, because if we have a steep gradient, but the size of the cluster is very small, it's going to sense different things, okay? So we modify the size of the cluster, and we can observe that if we reduce the size of the cluster, the durotaxis is less efficient. And we measure this data, and the experimental result obtain the same result. We obtain the same tendency. What happens if we try to break the connection between the cells? When we break the connection between the cells, what happens is the additions tend to appear between the cells. So the cells start to behave like single cells. There is no connection between them. And in this case, our model predicts the following result. When we have a monolayer, clearly we have a movement of the durotaxis phenomena, but when the cells are single, there is no durotaxis. We evaluate these experiments, and we can observe here in the video how durotaxis disappear when we break the connection between the cells. So in the next case, it's clear that this sensing phenomena is due to the forces that the cell are able to do when they are contracting. What happens if we use a drug to block the contracting force of the cells? We can observe here that the tendency, when we reduce the forces, the contraction forces, the durotaxis is less efficient. Durotaxis is reduced. When we did experiment with blevistatin, and we can observe that durotaxis disappear when we block the contraction forces. And the other phenomena that is very relevant is the cells have to be completely adhered to the substrate. Because if the adhesion is weak, the contraction is not transmitted to the substrate. So what we did is we are going to test the effect of the adhesion properties. And when we modify the addition, the durotaxis tend to reduce. And we observe exactly the same tendency in the experiments. So, with these ideas, we can obtain the following conclusion. It's clear that on a flat surface, migration is strongly dependent on matrix stiffness and surface addition. Durotaxis is mainly regulated by the stiffness gradient or equivalent by the size of the cell cluster. And we have presented a model that, and the model and the experiment, so the collective durotaxis is in fact an emergent phenomenon that is regulated by the cell-cell junction integrity, the myosin contractility, and the cell matrix addition. These three phenomena regulate cell migration in 2D. So now I'm going to start the second example, that is individual 3D migration. In 3D, there is a review paper. There are more aspects that not only matrix stiffness and adhesive properties. They are because the cell is embedded in a 3D architecture. So in this case, we have other properties like pore size, permeability, matrix degradation, and cell stiffness. To investigate the role of matrix mechanics, we are working developing microfluidic experiments. In this kind of experiment that we are developing, we have a central chamber that is in green, that is where we locate an hydrogel. Currently, we are working with collagen, but we have worked with fibrin, with PEG, with different materials. So we can culture the cells inside this chamber. And later, we have two external channels where we can add different kind of cells to do co-culture, or we can incorporate different chemical factors. In this way, we can, in an easy way, to recreate the environment of the cells. And in addition, we are able to locate these chips in a microscope, and we are able to quantify how is the cell movement in 3D, in the three dimensions and also in the time. And we have, in this kind of chip, a high control of the chemical gradients. So the objective of this work is to understand how does collagen concentration regulate 3D migration in human osteoblasts. For that, we need first to characterize very well how is the mechanical behavior of collagen hydrogels. We are going to quantify 3D migration patterns, and in parallel, we are going to develop the respective numerical models. So we observe that collagen gels have a high variability of properties. And we have studied this range of properties of different concentration. And in addition, we incorporate different kinds of cross-linkers. The first results are, we have developed different rheology measurements, and we can observe clearly that when we increase the collagen concentration, there is an increase of the shear modulus. But we observe two additional phenomena. One is very clear, and the highest concentration, 6 milligrams per millimeter, the gel tends to present a strange softening here. That it doesn't occur when we have low concentration. In addition, all the gels present a non-linear behavior, and so a strain hardening process. And the failure strains normally decrease in denser gels. We have also quantified the architecture of the gels using same techniques, and we observe the fiber density increase with collagen concentration and pore size decrease with collagen concentration. But it's also very important to understand the role of cross-linkers. There are many diseases associated with fibrosis. Fibrosis normally occurs due to the generation of different kinds of cross-linkers. Cross-linkers modify the properties of the network and improve properties. And mainly there are three kinds of type of crosslinker. Normally, physical crosslinker, that is the natural crosslinker of the collagen. Chemical crosslinker, but normally the chemical crosslinker are toxic for the cells. And later we have enzymatic crosslinker that are the most natural, more similar what occur in our bodies. So we have started to work with transglutaminase. When we add transglutaminase to our gels, what's happening, you can observe that this strain hardening disappears. We can observe here that the strain hardening is disappear completely when we incorporate transglutaminase. In addition, we observe that the strain hardening occurs earlier. We also quantify the architecture of the gels, and we can observe that clearly present a different network architecture. We have denser unions, and we can observe also here are more fibers, and here there are some structures that are like plates. We have tried to develop a model to simulate how these collagen gels behave. So there are different approaches, continuum, discrete. For this model, we have used a worldwide chain model, that is the typical model that simulates the force station behavior of the filaments and follow the McIntosh type model. And later we assume that this structure follows an A-chain model, following the proposal, the work proposed by Palmer and Boyce. So these are the equation of the constitutive equation, and I would like to remark that there are three fundamental parameters that we are going to adjust to predict the behavior of the gels. These parameters are the contour length, the fiber density, and the pre-stress alpha. So these three parameters, we are going to modify, to adjust these parameters to verify the behavior of the gels. So with this, we have adjusted, and we can observe this is without transglutaminase on the left, and on the right is with transglutaminase. And we observe that the contour length increases with collagen concentration, but decreases with transglutaminase. The fiber density increases with collagen and with transglutaminase, and the pre-stress increases with collagen, but decreases with transglutaminase. Okay, we have quantify, and we know much better how are our collagen gels where the cells are going to be cultured. So now we're going to measure the cell movement. To evaluate the cell movement, we are going to quantify two kinds of speed. What is called the effective speed is the speed between the initial point and the end point. And the mean speed is the speed in each instant that we take a picture. So, when we have a low effective speed and a low mean speed, it means that the cells move not very much. When we go to the low mean speed and high effective speed, the movement is much more directional. Okay? So, with these ideas in mind, we have compared what happened when we modify the collagen concentration. And we observe, here is the tracking of the cell that is done automatically, and we observe here the tendency. So in all the cases, the speed are very low. We have velocities of 0.1, the median value, microns per minute. And okay, they are very similar to the migration in fibroblast. And we observe that when we increase the concentration of the gel, the speed decreases. But of course, we observe that the effective speed is lower than the mean speed. Okay, so it means that the cell tend to move rounding. Okay, we observe here the differences in speed. So now, what we try is to create a model that is able to predict the movement of these cells. When we have a human osteoblast initially in 3D, we are going to see how is the initial process of protrusion formation. We observe that protrusion formation of polarization is not well defined. It's clearly a case of competition. So the protrusions are formed in a competing way. So to model this, we assume that the osteoblast is a set of bars, and we assume that the protrusion dynamics determine this migration. We only simulate the primary protrusion, and we assume intracellular signal processes to understand how a process is activated in the cell surface. It creates the response that the protrusion occurs. Currently, it's a stochastic process, so we simulate here that there is a environmental factor, extracellular factor, that activate a receptor. At this receptor, internally activate the PI3K, that is an internal molecule, and this is the molecule that regulate the protrusion formation. Okay, for that, we use different kind of algorithms, but the idea is, at the end, the protrusion occurs in a specific position of the cell body. So, once that we have a protrusion, the idea of the model is quite simple. Myosin induces contraction of this protrusion. When we contract the protrusion, compression forces occur in the protrusion, and these compression forces regulate the polymerization rate through this law, and in this way, the protrusions tend to grow or to decrease, okay? When the size of the protrusion is shorter than a side, then it is removed or it is stopped. So this model is simulated in abacus, and I show you some preliminary results how the cells tend to move differently in 2 milligrams or in 4 milligrams. If we do a more quantitative analysis, we observe the following result. This is the experimental result, and this is the simulation. We observe that the median value is quite good, and we obtain a low value of the variability. We also have variability in our measurements, but our variability are lower than they obtain in experiments. But we are not only happy quantifying the velocities. Our intention is to quantify how is the graph of this protrusion. And we can observe in these videos how is the dynamics of protrusions in the two conditions. If you observe in 2 milligrams, initially the osteoblasts, the protrusion are competing, but clearly at the end, one protrusion in this gear is who wins, and in this moment, the nucleus tend to move along the protrusion. However, in the case of 4 milligrams per millimeter, the protrusions are still competing. The cell center is moving, but there is not a clear direction of movement. The protrusions are still competing between them. So, as preliminary result, we have obtained that in the case of 2 milligrams per millimeter, we obtain longer protrusions than in the case of 4 milligrams per millimeter. In this case, the size of the protrusion are shorter. Of course, there are variability in the measurements, and our model is able to predict this tendency. We observe also high variability, more variability in 2 milligrams per millimeter than in 4, and we observe that the median values are in quite good agreement with the experimental measurements. The final topic in which we are working is what is the role of degradation. If you see this picture, we have here the osteoblast, and you can see here there is a hole. This hole has been created by the cell for moving. So what we did is we incorporate marimastat in order to block the activity of metalloprotease, so to block the capacity of cells to eat the matrix. Okay? And in this moment, we observe a significant difference. So we observe a loss of speed, very significant. It means when cells are moving, that not only certain forces, they are removing matrix, they are degrading matrix. So it's very relevant when we study cell migration to consider the effect of degradation. So my conclusions in this part are collagen matrix present strain hardening at medium light strains, cross-linker induce early strain hardening, protrusion dynamics define the cell motility pattern, and matrix mechanics can regulate the protrusion dynamics. And finally, degradation is a crucial mechanism in 3D migration. Finally, I study the effect of the cell stiffness. So, the capacity of deformation of the cell is also very relevant for migration. Really, in 3D migration, that is different than in 2D migration, there is a balance between the capacity of cell to deform and the physical constraints of the matrix. So the cells create space and exert forces to try to advance inside the matrix. So our idea now is to focus our work to try to investigate how is the role of how much important is the role of the cell stiffness. For that, we have done experiments with breast carcinoma cells. We have control cells, and later we modify the properties of the nucleus with overexpression of the nuclear protein that produce an increase of more or less 47%. And later, with this, we modify the nucleus properties. And later, we add in the cytoskeleton polystyrene beads to modify the properties of the cell. We have developed this experiment with collaboration with a group of Professor Ben Fabry. So what we did is to culture these cells, these three kinds of cells, and in this surface, and later we are going to study the invasion capacity. So in the blue line, we observe that the invasion capacity for the same probability is about 500 microns, and the cells that we modify the nucleus, although the nucleus is 50% higher, the capacity of invasion is very similar. So there are no differences in this case. However, if we modify the properties of the cytoskeleton, the invasion capacity, this is the red line, is very reduced. So it's clear that the nucleus, the cell, at least is able, in this concentration of gel, to modify the environment to move and to have the same capacity of movement. How are doing cells this? So for that, we try to quantify the forces that the cells are doing. And we solve a problem of traction for microscopy. We culture the cells in the